I'm Scott from WartimeNI, and I'm in Belfast. I'm on Queen's Island in the northeast of the city, home to the world-famous Harland and Wolff shipyard and the birthplace of a truly unsinkable ship. In April and May 1941, this part of the city of Belfast felt the full force of the German Luftwaffe. In two separate raids, high-explosive bombs hammered the docks and slipways, ships sustained damage at their moorings, and incendiaries that ignited tool sheds, paint halls, and workshops. Just 3 years earlier, however, the same shipyard was a scene of jubilation. Crowds gathered in buoyant mood. It was St. Patrick's Day, 17th of March 1938, and Mrs. Anne de Vere Chamberlain, wife of then British Prime Minister Neville Chamberlain, was in town. On St. Patrick's Day, 17th of March 1938, a crowd of up to 10,000 people gathered on Queen's Island. Newspapers at the time likened the throng of exuberant people to that on the way to an international football match. While ship launches were relatively common in the city's shipyard, it had been many years since the island had witnessed such a crowd. The Belfast Telegraph made reference to the lusty cheering of those assembled, awaiting the arrival of Mrs. Chamberlain and other dignitaries. The newspaper went on to state, "It was a great day in the history of Belfast shipbuilding industry. The Belfast, which will be one of the two most powerful cruisers in the Royal Navy on her completion within the next 12 months, is only the second warship built by Messrs. Harland and Wolff Limited since the war. When Mrs. Chamberlain did arrive on Queen's Island, she and the other dignitaries were mobbed by a large number of shipyard workers and sightseers. Those assembled stood on tiptoe and scrambled for vantage points to catch a glimpse of the historic proceedings." Along with the wife of then British Prime Minister, were the Duke of Abercorn, Governor of Northern Ireland, Viscount Craigavon, Prime Minister of Northern Ireland, and Mr. F.E. Rebeck, the Chairman of Harland and Wolff Limited. As the dignitaries made their way through the heaving crowds, Viscount Craigavon lost sight of the others. Such was the size and excitement of the crowd. He spent some time chatting to shipyard men before making his way back to the platform party. He, Mrs. Chamberlain, and the others also signed many autograph books along the way. Once assembled, a space was made next to Mrs. Chamberlain. Next to her stood 15-year-old liner-off boy Robert McBride. He shyly doffed his cap, wiped his hands on his overalls, and presented a beautiful bouquet to Mrs. Chamberlain. For her part, she genuinely appeared delighted with the warmth of the Ulster welcome as cheers went up throughout the audience. There were shouts of "Good old Chamberlain," and "Tell him to keep Ulster in the United Kingdom." Workers in the yards and engine works at Down Tools, thousands of men, women and children hustled for position around the ship, which stood in the middle of three building slipways in the east yard. On one side stood the almost complete Union class liner Cape Town Castle, on the other, under construction, the aircraft carrier HMS Formidable. Staging on the decks of both ships provided a grandstand view of the following events for hundreds of workmen. All eyes were on Belfast. Newspaper reports described the ship as an engrossing sight. The long, low hull at almost 200 yards in length, the light naval grey paintwork created an impression of sleekness and speed as the sun shone on the ship. Amidships, the weight of armour plating was noticeable. There was no doubt that this was a fighting ship. Even with only a small amount of the superstructure in place, there was a bulk and strength to Belfast that impressed onlookers. A strong breeze rippled the Union Jack flying from the bow. The flag of Harland and Wolff Shipyard fluttered over the deck, where soon the bridge would stand. In line with the traditions of the Royal Navy, a short religious service took place before the ship's launch. Then, with prayers offered up, it was time for the 10,000-ton cruiser to take to the water. At exactly 11:45 a.m., Mrs. Chamberlain christened the vessel, releasing and breaking a bottle of Empire wine, lavishly decorated with red, white and blue ribbons, across the bows. She proclaimed, "I name this ship Belfast. May God guide her and guard and keep all who sail in her." The Belfast Telegraph described the launch, keenly noticing the speed and strength that Belfast would go on to exhibit throughout its naval career. In the water, she presented a fine picture. The long, graceful lines were brought out by the light grey of her hull, on which the sun shone brilliantly. The ship itself and her launch were a credit to the Belfast men who built her, and there were exclamations of admiration on every side for the perfection of her lines. The Belfast, there is no doubt, will be one of the finest ships in the rebuilt British Navy.